Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
I don't know about you, but if you ever feel like the odds are stacked against you, then this text we're looking at today has something to say to you. I'm picking up where Pastor James left off last week about Gideon. We're in Judges chapter 7. Pastor James preached chapter 6 last week, and let's read the text, and I want to make a clear, simple point for you. Then, verse 1, Judges 7, then Jerubbaal, that is Gideon, and all the people who were with him rose early and encamped beside the spring at Harod. And the camp of Midian was north of them by the hill of Moreh in the valley. The Lord said to Gideon, the people with you are too many for me to give the Midianites into their hand, lest Israel boast over me, saying, my own hand has saved me. Now therefore proclaim in the ears of the people, saying, whoever is fearful and trembling, let him return home and hurry away from Mount Gilead. Then 22,000 of the people returned and 10,000 remained. And the Lord said to Gideon, the people are still too many. Take them down to the water, and I will test them for you there. And anyone whom I say to you, this one shall go with you, shall go with you. And anyone of whom I say to you, this one shall not go, shall not go. So he brought the people down to the water, and the Lord said to Gideon, everyone who laps the water with his tongue as a dog laps, you shall set by himself. Likewise, everyone who kneels down to drink. And the number of those who lapped, putting their hands to their mouth, was 300. But all the rest of the people knelt down to drink water. And the Lord said to Gideon, with the 300 men who lapped, I will save you and the Midianites. Save you and give the Midianites into your hand. And let all the others go, every man to his home. Verse 8. So the people took provisions in their hands and their trumpets, and he sent all the rest of Israel, every man to his tent, but he retained the 300 men. And the camp of Midian was below him in the valley. Now, that camp of Midian was interesting. The camp of Midian was described this way in verse 12. The Midianites and the Amalekites and all the people of the east lay along the valley, look at this, like locusts in abundance. And their camels were without number, and that and this as the sand that is on the seashore in abundance. Think about this, how many Midianites there were. This is a massive army like locusts, camels without number. Have you ever tried to count the sand on the beach? He's exaggerating, trying to paint this picture of this massive army arrayed against them. And what we hear in the story, there are only 32,000 to start with against the sand and countless camels and all of this. But to understand the book of Judges, let me explain it real simply this way, the whole book of Judges. The book of Judges takes 400 years from the time of Joshua dying until the time of the prophet Samuel, who ushers in Saul and David and Solomon in this great kingdom. So from that time, from Joshua, who followed Moses, Joshua, to 400 years. But here's what happens to the nation. There's this cycle, continuous cycle of apostasy, judgment, and then deliverance. And then deliverance would bring this great time of peace and prosperity and blessing, and then they would forget God. And they would go into apostasy, which apostasy was typically, in the book of Judges, idolatry and adultery. Idolatry, worshiping false gods, and sexual immorality. This apostasy would happen. They would go far from God, and then the judgment of God would come. And the judgment of God comes on sin. And then finally it would get so bad that they would cry out to God and he would raise up a deliverer. And they're called judges in the book of Judges. They're not like judicial judges. They're deliverers is maybe a better word for in our context. And there were 12 of these deliverers, people like Samson and Ehud and Deborah and Jephthah and the one we're looking at today, Gideon. In this cycle for 400 years, and this deliverer would rise up. and they would get set free. They would turn back to God, and there would be peace and prosperity and just great times. And then you know what happened again? They'd forget God. Sometimes a generation, sometimes two generations, sometimes three generations, but they would forget God, and they would start worshiping false gods. And they would get into all types of immorality. And then God would bring judgment through the Canaanites, the Amalekites, the Jebusites, the Amorites, the Philistines. And every single time there was a different warrior nation that would attack and bring judgment in this cycle over and over and over. So what we're looking at is one of those cycles now with Gideon. And it's these violent warrior people who are coming against the shepherds. They're sheep herders. Now, what we find here, chapter 8 describes, actually gives a number to the description. Remember the description of the Midianite army? Like locusts, too many camels to count, like the sand on the sea. That's a lot of people. But when it comes down to it, it's 135,000 people, chapter 8 tells us. 135,000 people. And so what happens is, we're told, Gideon has rounded up 32,000. And right on the other side of this little hill, it says mountain, but it's a hill. I've been there. Pastor James will be there in a couple of days. On the other side of the hill is 135,000 armed, violent, scarred up, trained warriors. 32,000 shepherds. That's 4-1. But you know what the word of the Lord is in chapter 7, verse 2? 135,000 versus 32,000. And you know what verse 2 says? God said, that's too many. And don't you know Gideon's going, that's right, that's way too many. We need more. No. God said, no. 32,000 is too many. Have you ever heard a word from the Lord that didn't make any sense? He's like, wait, God, you don't understand. You ever prayed that prayer? God, you don't get it. You don't understand what I'm going through. What do you mean that's too many? That's what he says, that's too many. So he does the fear to everybody who's afraid, go home. If you have any kind of fear, go home. How many of you would have gone home then? I'm home, I'm out of there. I mean, there's 32,000 of us shepherds, and there's 135,000 violent, bloody warriors there. Who wouldn't be afraid? Only those people who were crazy. I would have been one of the 22,000, I am certain. So now, they're down to 10,000. It's 135,000 to 10,000. You know what verse 4 says? You can guess what verse 4 says? God says, that's too many. That's not fair. At that point, don't you know Gideon and everyone else is going, God, we need more. And God's going, no, you don't need more. You actually have too much. And so they give another test, and he says, take everybody to the river. And I remember, this is where Pastor James will be in a couple of days. I remember there with a teacher. I was with a bunch of pastors, and we got to that little creek, river, and he painted this picture of these, now 10,000 people have been walking through, and they see water, and they just run. I mean, it's the hot sun in the desert. You see this water, and most of them just fall face down and just start drinking water like you could imagine. You're thirsty. You see water. You're down there. You're splashing it. You're drinking. That was 9,700 of the 10,000 did it that way. But he said there were 300 who got down like this, kept looking at the horizon, and scooped water up to their mouth and lapped it like a dog with their tongue out of their hand, like this. Now, our teacher in Israel said, those were the ones who were alert. That's who you want on your army, not those who just splashed out. And he was kind of trying to say, he was kind of telling us, 300 alert, sharp people are better off against 135,000. I'm going, I don't think so. Now, I've read other commentary, other scholars in Scripture, and it seems like most of the scholars look at that and say, because he uses the phrase in Scripture, a dog. They drank like a dog, and that was one of the worst insults you could give someone in that culture in that day. Remember Jesus did the dog thing about, you know, the bread is not for the, it's for the children, not the dogs. And that she said, even the dogs get this. And it was a weird scripture, but there's something to that about calling someone a dog was, and so there's also a picture of were these 300 picked, like they were these great, a gang of Navy SEALs who could go up against, that's what, or was it the opposite being said? Like, not only am I taking your numbers away, but you're going to be left with a bunch of dogs. We're insulting these people as far as they could be insulted. That's the group you have. Like David in the cave with everybody who's depressed and everybody who's in debt and everybody who's discouraged, and that's the mighty army. I don't know which one it is. Either way, if you've got 300 special forces or 300 bums, still against 135,000, you lose one way or the other, right? But it's not just the numbers, because God says that's still too much. This is 135,000 armed, violent warriors against 300 trumpet players. Do you notice the scripture never mentions any weapons these guys have? They have trumpets. And when the 9,700 were told to leave, you know what it says? They gathered the trumpets from them. Hey, wait a minute. We're about to have a war. Don't leave. You leave that trumpet here. I got a feeling it's the dog explanation. These are like, man, we're going to need that trumpet. It's a strange story, isn't it? God said it's too much. At this point, most preachers would be really tempted to pull out of this story three steps to victory. As if the Bible's written so that everywhere in the scripture is some kind of code so our life will turn out okay. And let's watch what Gideon did so we can live in victory. I hate to disappoint you, but that's not what the Bible is written for. It's not a step-by-step book of how our life can turn out wonderfully. The Bible's actually written so we could know ourselves and know God. It's a mirror. The Bible's described as a mirror. And when you look in the mirror, you see stuff that you don't like. Unless you're just incredibly vain. But you look and you see things in your teeth and you see things that need to be fixed. It's a mirror that shows us just what we are. But it also is a picture of who God is and how He deals with us. Now, when I think about this, it's not a three steps to victory, but it is a picture of God so we can really know Him. Here's a theological explanation for what's going on. And theology is simply a study of God. As we study God in this and try to find Him, there's a theological truth that we can embrace from this story. Odd story that it is. Let me explain it this way. When I got home from the office Friday, my wife is extremely organized and detailed in our house. Everything has a place and everything is, I don't ever come home to an untidy home, and I'm thankful for that. But when I walked in the door Friday, the kitchen looked like a hurricane blew through. And I was met at the door with my 5.5-year-old granddaughter, so excited. She said, "Pops, you gotta see." And she pulls me in, and I'm looking around. There is stuff everywhere because she was making Valentine's cupcakes. And boy, it was a mess. There was stuff everywhere, and her 2-year-old little brother was on the floor eating sprinkles that had fallen off with. And he had his hand in the icing tub and sprinkles and dirt, and there's all kind of stuff. It reminded me of 6 months ago at her birthday. When I went to her birthday at her house, there was a cake that was a piece of art. Her mother, my daughter-in-law, makes cakes that are works of art. They're like on the Food Channel, the cake shows. They're like that. And she couldn't wait that time. 6 months ago, I get there, she can't wait to show me this cake that she made. And she told me, I made this cake, Pops, and then she said it kind of quiet, but Mom helped. And so she was making cupcakes at my house, and her grandmother was helping. I think we all know the truth. Her mother doesn't need her help. And my wife doesn't need her help. In fact, when she helps, it takes longer. The more she helps, the longer it takes. Also, when she helps, the cleanup is massive. The post-cake work is not doubled, it's like times 10, right? Sometimes it tastes the same. And here's the theological truth. If my granddaughter were giving a theological treatise on Judges 7 and 8, here's what she would say. Gideon did it, and God helped. And the sad thing is, that's how a lot of us live our lives. We want to go do stuff, and it ends up odds stacked against us. It ends up a mess, whether it's our finances, our marriage, our health, whatever we do. And then we want God to come help us fix it. I think there's another option. The other option is not just that Gideon did something and God helped him, but God did it, but Gideon helped. But that's equally problematic theologically. Because God doesn't need our help. God didn't need Gideon's help. In fact, the more Gideon helped God, the longer it took and the bigger the mess was. That's typically what happens when we help God. But the theological reality of it is this. It's not Gideon did it and God helped. It's not God did it and Gideon helped him. The truth of this is this. God did it, and he let Gideon be involved in his great kingdom business. Now, why? This isn't a text, a scripture, a story about how to win the victories in life. That's not it. But it really is a picture of how God works and why he works. And what we find when the odds are stacked against us, like my friend in prison without a lawyer in a nation where sharing the gospel was illegal, or like Gideon right here, when the odds are 450 to 1. All right? Okay, he goes from 4 to 1 to 10,000 to 135,000. That's 14 to 1. And then he goes 135,000 to 300. That's 450 to 1. Those are bad odds stacked against him. But what's the message? It's in verse 2. He says, God says, these people are too many. Lord, I thought it wasn't enough. I thought I needed more, not less. No, you need less. It's too many. Lest you boast, saying, my own hand has saved me. And listen, the tendency of fallen humans like you and I is to think we can save ourselves. Is to think we can save our marriages, to think we can save our parents, to think we can save our city, to think we can save whatever it is we're trying to save. And ultimately to think that we in some way contribute to our own eternal salvation. But the message here is, it's the work of God. We don't help him, but he wants us involved. You know why my wife tolerated the messy kitchen? Because she wants her granddaughter to be involved because of her relationship. You know why her mother, who makes beautiful cakes without help? Because she wants the relationship. You know why God lets us get involved in kingdom business? It's not because he needs our help. It's because he wants our relationship. Now, I want to end with this thought. We're out of time. I used to think growing up, going to church a little bit, that I could save myself if my good outweighed my bad. When I became familiar with Scripture and the gospel, I realized I could not ever save myself if my good outweighed my bad, because my good would never outweigh my bad. But what I realized, the gospel says I can be saved because God's good outweighs my bad. And that if I would put my full faith and trust in His goodness, not my goodness, I could receive the free gift of eternal life. Now, I want to pause, end right here, and I want to pray. I want to ask the ministry team to come forward, and I want to say something about this. If you're in ministry team, come up here. We're going to pray in just a moment as we wrap up. If you have things in your life, and it's against the odds, it's 450-1. There's no way this thing works. You're in prison on trial with no lawyer. Whatever is happening, and you need someone to pray with you, we're here to do that. I say pray with you because that's important. We're not here to pray for you, as if God answers their prayers because they have a name tag on quicker than He answers yours. It's not the way it works. We'll pray with you, stand with you in faith. Also, if you have never put your faith in the finished work of Christ on the cross for your eternal salvation, we want to pray with you also. If you want to give your life to Jesus, if you want to return to Christ, or if you're walking with Him and you just have such a thing you're facing like Gideon, and humanly it's impossible, we want to stand with you in faith and believe God to meet you in the midst of this. Why? Because you can't save yourself. And He doesn't want us thinking for one second that we save ourselves. Whatever good happens, it comes from Him.
If you've watched this message and you want to make Jesus Lord of your life, I've got good news. You can do it right now. I want you to pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge I am a sinner. I need You, my Savior. I believe You died for me. I believe You were raised from the dead on the third day. And I confess that You are now Lord of my life. If you've just prayed that prayer, I have good news for you. You have eternal life. The next step for you is to get in a Bible-believing church. We volunteer to be that church. But if not us, we pray God's blessings on you as you search for God's best for you. Thank you.